A very long time ago, we did an episode on post-war Japan where we talked about political reforms and new constitutions, and even Goku and Godzilla got a mention. But what we didn't talk about in any detail was how a country whose economy was so devastated by the effects of war, how it managed to turn itself around and, within a few decades, become one of the world's leading economic powers. I'm your host, David, and today we are going to talk about the Japanese economic miracle. This is the Cold War. Now, speaking of Japan and miracles, the sponsor of today's video, Boksu, offers a truly unique product. Boksu is a monthly snack box subscription that partners with century-old family snack makers to deliver exclusive Japanese snacks and tea pairings to your door. Every month, you'll receive a box with a different theme and different snacks. It's a gourmet journey through Japan every month. March is the start of Hanami in Japan, that's cherry blossom season, and so to celebrate, Boksu orders placed by March 15th will get a special Hanami-themed pink box. But be quick, as stocks are limited. Boksu has sent us one of these boxes, and it has everything you need to be in Japanese bliss. Sweet, sour, spicy, fruity. Our favorite was white strawberry. So good. You can order an individual box, single month, or multi-month subscriptions starting at $36.99 per box. Auto-renew with the option to pause or cancel anytime. Your first box will ship out within 1 to 2 weeks straight from Japan. Ordering Boksu is one of the best ways to bring Japan into your home, so get 10% off your own authentic Japanese snack box from Boksu and save up to $47 using our code and link in the description. Don't forget that this also supports our channel. Japan, by August of 1945, ranked high on the list of the most devastated countries from the Second World War. They had lost anywhere between 1.8 and 2.8 million people, while also losing about 25% of their national wealth, excluding military stock. Industrial production in the immediate post-war period was a mere one-tenth of pre-war levels, and housing and accommodation had been reduced by a quarter. A huge number of buildings that had been used for industrial and commercial purposes had been destroyed, and much of the plants and machinery involved in civilian production had been scrapped to turn into war munitions. And what was one of the biggest direct problems this created? Well, unemployment. At war's end, 7.6 million soldiers were demobilized, with an additional 4 million civilians who had been working in military-related jobs suddenly found themselves with no work. Then add in as many as 1.5 million more people returning from territories abroad that Japan had occupied. Some simple math puts this over 13 million people of a total population of approximately 71 million people. But unemployment wasn't the only issue. Japan also had to deal with major food and energy shortages. Coal had long been the primary source of energy in Japan, but coal production had suffered a significant blow when the Chinese and Korean prisoners of war, who had been forced to work in the mines, simply refused to work anymore. The supply of food also suffered major shortages due to inefficiencies in the feudal nature of Japanese agricultural production, especially when compared to other developed nations at the time. This was in spite of many of the unemployed returning to the land. And there was still another major issue in play as well: inflation. Large volumes of currency had flown into the monetary system after the war ended, largely from provisional military expenses. This was the salaries for demobilized soldiers, payments for completed orders of military goods, advance payments, compensation for losses, and so on. But it wasn't all bad. After all, Japan before the war had been among the most powerful nations in the world, with a strong economic backbone and a highly educated and trained workforce. The institutional memory of this, coupled with that skilled workforce, laid the groundwork for the economic recovery that was to come. And one more key factor, the recovery was something pushed by the American Occupation Administration. The Americans wanted to ensure that Japan was both demilitarized and democratized, and the 1947 Constitution of Japan enshrined the idea that Japan would give up rights to its military force and rely on the US for protection. This allowed Japan to allocate what would have gone to military spending to other spheres. they literally ignored the swords and focused only on the plowshares. So that's the background. What actual steps were taken, though? Well, to start, one of the pillars of Imperial Japan's economic power was dismantled, the Zaibatsu. No, not the crime syndicate from GTA 2. Zaibatsu were the industrial conglomerates that had received preferential treatment from the imperial government by means of lower taxes and even monetary injections to easily allow their expansion. By concentrating economic control in the hands of the Zaibatsu, it allowed for a continuation of the semi-feudal relationship that existed between labor and management and held down wages, blocked the development of labor unions, obstructed the creation of new firms through entrepreneurial means, and hindered the development of a Japanese middle class. The Zaibatsu were ended by breaking up the holding companies which controlled them and then selling their stocks to the public. At the same time this was happening, the anti-monopoly and decentralization laws were adopted, which prohibited all cartel activities and aimed to prevent firms from becoming too large. So there's the industrial reform, but the occupation administration also took a shot at land reform. Prior to the occupation, much of the land in Japan was owned by large landlords who would rent it to peasants to be worked. Feudal in nature, it largely resulted in inefficient use of the land. With only 54% of the land being owner-operated, a program where the government bought up land and then redistributed it to farmers resulted in 90% of the land being worked by owner-operators by 1950. The speed that this took place at is truly astonishing. And even more remarkably, the class of large landowners all but ceased to exist. And there's one more major reform that was going to contribute to the blossoming of the Japanese economy, the trade union law. Imperial Japan had basically given zero tolerance to union activities, and as a result, in 1945, there was no trade union infrastructure to build from. But the 1945 trade union law looked to rectify that, creating the basic right of workers in private industry to organize, to bargain collectively, and to strike. It also allowed for democratic procedures in all union activities, established a labor relations commission, and prohibited unfair labor practices by employers. 4 years later, in 1949, the number of unionized workers had increased to nearly 60% of the workforce. The law facilitated early improvements in wage increases and working conditions. It also paved the way for the lifetime employment system, which helped stabilize the relationship between capital and the worker, ensuring long-term employment and increased wages and privileges towards the end of the worker's career. Workers would join a company when they were young and remain there until they retired. The advantage to this is that they would move around to various positions within the same organization, gaining a wide cross-section of experience, which it was claimed helped prepare them for higher responsibility roles as they understood more of the business. As a quick criticism of this, the lifetime employment scheme benefited primarily men able to hold full-time industry jobs. Women and those involved in part-time work or service industry work were left out of these otherwise significant benefits. So, the American plan had originally been to slowly recover the Japanese economy. And then the realities of the Cold War intervened and forced a change to that policy. By 1948, Washington was already looking at ways to help turn Japan into a strong anti-communist bulwark in East Asia, independent of American financial aid. That was the year the president of the Detroit Bank, Joseph Dodge, fresh from his work helping to rebuild the German banking system, began working on his plan for Japan, to help ensure the country would be strong and independent, but still inside the U.S. sphere of influence. Early 1949 saw what has become known as the Dodge Line, outlining key elements of what needed to be done. First of all, balanced budgets were critical. Second was the suspension of new loans from the Reconstruction Finance Bank as a measure to bring inflation under control. Third and fourth was the establishment of a fixed currency exchange rate and the removal of government subsidies as part of an overall attempt to decrease state intervention in economics. The long-term effect of the Dodge Line was met, but in the short term, these austerity measures had the effect of pushing Japan into a recession as economic challenges mounted. But then, the Cold War intervened. The outbreak of the war on the Korean Peninsula provided a massive economic boost for Japan. And why might that be? Well, the United States realized that procuring goods and equipment to support the conflict would be significantly cheaper if it was done from Japan rather than the United States. The growth in the Japanese economy was tremendous, estimated at almost 70% growth by the time the 1953 armistice was established. It should also be noted that not only was manufacturing greatly expanded, but the amount of foreign currency that was being brought into the country was massive. The US military, between defense contract spending and that of soldiers, brought in as much as $590 million in 1951 and over $800 million in each of 1952 and 1953. This additional income, albeit temporary, allowed Japan to cover the costs of 60 to 70% of its imports and subsequently raise their exports to about $2 billion a year. For Japan, which relied heavily on imports of raw and unfinished materials for its own manufacturing sector, this allowed them to almost double their output and achieve even greater scales of economy. The larger profits this provided then allowed those firms to reinvest the profits into new equipment and technology, which in turn resulted in greater capacity and greater profits, and, well, so on and so forth. Of course, the economic boom spurred on by the Korean War did nothing to help material shortages in the country or inflation. And then the Korean War ended. Japan suddenly lost access to the tap of foreign investment that had been flowing money into the rebuilding country. As scarcity of capital began to cut into the country's expansion, Americans once again stepped in. This time, it was by lobbying for increased foreign loans to Japan, and by 1958, these had more than doubled, led by the World Bank, but strongly supported by US domestic banks looking to make significant returns on their investment. By the late 1950s, American leadership had fully taken on the responsibility of protecting Japan from foreign threats. Japan had established the Japan Self-Defense Forces in 1954, but the agreement with the US allowed them to reduce budget spending by 20% between 1958 and 1960, a figure that continued to drop until it was below 1% of GDP by 1970. And what did this allow Japan to do? Well, it allowed them to shift resources that would have gone towards defense spending to be focused on commercial investment. Economic historians Hugh T. Patrick and Henry Rosofsky have estimated that Japan's economy would have been up to 30% smaller by 1976 had they continued to spend on defense. And as if all this wasn't enough on its own, the United States also used its influence on the global stage to lobby other countries to remove restrictions on Japanese imports. And just to show how serious they were about this, successive American governments resisted calls from American lobby groups to impose their own protectionist tariffs on Japanese goods entering the US market. Between 1958 and 1960, Japanese exports to the United States increased by 150%. In total, 30% of Japanese exports were to the United States. And the results? Well, bigger profits, allowing for further investment into the economy, industry, and services. The preferential treatment of Japanese firms by the Americans would be maintained until the Nixon administration. Now, you've probably noticed that all of this we've talked about so far looks like it's been pushed by the Americans onto the Japanese. This isn't true, though. Japanese leadership in the post-war era was quite supportive of the strategic alliance being formed with the United States and was promoting similar policies to assist in the economic recovery. One of the champions of Japanese demilitarization was Shigeru Yoshida, an early prime minister and often considered to be the father of the modern Japanese economy. He was a firm proponent of freeing Japan from military spending and redirecting that money into economic development, which he began espousing as early as the Korean War period. We should also mention Hayato Ikeda, prime minister from 1960 to 1964, most recognized for his income-doubling plan, where he looked to double the income of Japanese workers by 1970. He looked to do this by means of tax breaks, targeted government investments into strategic industries, the stimulation of heavy industry, increased exports, and increased social protections. And how successful was this plan? Well, it achieved its goal 3 years ahead of schedule. The Japanese economy more than doubled in 7 years. In 1968, less than 22 years after losing the war, the Japanese economy was the second largest in the world. So, now that we have an overview of the economic recovery, why don't we talk a bit about some of the other factors and the key players that enabled it to happen? We'll start with the Ministry of International Trade and Industry, one of the key factors that allowed for the recovery. MITI is often considered to be the single most powerful government structure involved during the high growth period. MITI's policy was to prioritize and provide favorable conditions for the most strategic industries in Japan. Through MITI and the large amounts of financial aid and assistance it was able to arrange, industries like steel, shipbuilding, chemicals, and machine manufacturing grew rapidly, especially in international markets, but this was at the expense of other industries due to the unlevel playing fields that MITI created. The Japanese banking system also played a key role in the implementation of the policies set in Tokyo. The Bank of Japan would provide loans to city banks, and they would then provide loans to individual companies, especially those which had been determined to have high growth potential. Individual city banks and companies would develop long-term relationships with each other, where companies would come to rely on steady loans from the bank to continue investing in the company. The so-called main bank would also act as an agent for investors and lenders to the company, examining the viability of investment projects and even monitoring the performance of management. In Japan, individual shareholders did not monitor management efforts, and institutional investors didn't exercise the same level of monitoring powers as seen in the United States. This tended to mean that there was less pressure for high dividends, allowing for companies to focus investment dollars on long-term growth strategies to help get their products into global markets. Okay, now remember how I said earlier that the zaibatsu had been broken up after the Japanese surrender? And you also remember how I said that some companies and industries got higher levels of support from the government? Well, those regulations that had been used to break up the zaibatsu did not actually last that long and were soon eased. This allowed for, well, you guessed it, the formation of large companies that could dominate industries. They were called keiretsu, or enterprise groups. Keiretsu could be formed horizontally across different industries, or vertically inside an industry where it would control suppliers and manufacturers, as well as distribution. The big six keiretsu, which you already may be familiar with, are Mitsubishi, Mitsui, Sumitomo, Ikan, Fuyu, and Sanwa. So, the keiretsu, remarkably like the zaibatsu, would be umbrellas for dozens of large companies involved in manufacturing, finance, services, sales, and multitudes of other businesses, all cooperating with each other. Each keiretsu had its own relationship to the main bank overseeing progress. Although this was an unfair market for new companies trying to enter, it did allow for already large companies to grow and quickly move into global markets, benefiting Japan greatly. There were some social aspects as well that contributed to the Japanese recovery. Japan, long a patriarchal society that had fostered tight familial bonds, had a tradition where the head of household could forbid family from moving away for work or any other reason. Part of what came with the political transformation in the post-war period was a loosening of this traditionalism. This meant that suddenly the working population was far more mobile than it had been in the past. It also meant that many people moved away from agricultural work to more profitable industrial work. Paired with the high levels of Japanese education, this was a potent mixture, allowing for rapid development. And now, as we start to wrap up this longer than usual episode, how about some numbers to illustrate this growth? By 1956, real per capita GDP had overtaken the level reached in 1940. From the mid-1950s until the oil shocks of the early 1970s, the Japanese economy averaged a growth rate of 10% a year. This meant that between 1958 and 1974, the Japanese economy expanded fourfold. The Japanese economic miracle is a stunning example of economic recovery. It was undertaken to build Japan into an anti-communist linchpin in East Asia that the United States could use as a secure military platform as part of their policy of containment. First, taking advantage of its strategic location next to the first major conflict of the Cold War, Japan then gave up responsibility for its own defense and used that to its own advantage again. All of this very rapidly placed Japan at almost the pinnacle of economic dominance. It's hard to imagine today what Japan and the world might look like without the Japanese economic miracle. And that being said, I'm going to go get in my Mazda, drive home, and play PlayStation. We hope that you've enjoyed today's episode, but to make sure you don't miss all of our future episodes, please make sure you're subscribed to our channel and have heavily subsidized the bell button, giving it a massive competitive advantage over all other bell buttons. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com, and we're active on Facebook and Instagram at thecoldwartv. If you enjoy our work, please consider supporting us via www.patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. And don't forget, the trouble with the Cold War is that it doesn't take too long before it gets heated.